Welcome back, everyone, to today's episode of Klever Live, where we take you deeper into the world of Bitcoin, crypto, blockchain, and of course, the ever-expanding ecosystem of Klever. We just came home from Bitcoin 2022, and oh boy, what an experience. Me, Dio, JP, Sam, Matthias, and a bunch of the Klever community was there, spreading the word of Klever, learning, meeting some very interesting people, and we can't share much yet, but stay tuned. A lot is coming. Don't forget to smash that like button, subscribe to the channel, of course, share this live session with your friends and family all around the world. Today, our guest is one of the leading actors of our blockchain partner, Dfinity, and their protocol, Internet Computer. You may know it as ICP. Klever today supports ICP for holding, sending, receiving, buying ICP with credit card or Apple Pay directly inside of Klever Wallet, and of course, ICP staking and Neuron rewards. Dfinity is the foundation that is building the Internet Computer. They have offices in Zurich, San Francisco, Palo Alto, Tokyo, to mention a few. The majority of the Dfinity team is composed of software engineers and researchers, many of them in the field of cryptography. Internet Computer is, let's just say, a very ambitious project. They are a set of protocols that allow independent data centers around the world to band together and offer a decentralized alternative to the current centralized internet cloud providers. The ICP token is used for governance, to reward network participants' good behavior, and of course to pay transaction fees. The Internet Computer introduces a completely novel public blockchain protocol that the Dfinity team upholds is the first blockchain to be infinitely scalable. We'll clearly ask our guest about that. First to run at web speed, and first that enables smart contracts to answer HTTP requests to serve interactive content directly to end users. Today's guest is Jan Camenisch, the CTO of Dfinity and a leading scientist in the areas of privacy and cryptography, who has published over 120 widely cited papers. Previously, he spent 19 years as principal research staff member at IBM, where he co-invented Identity Mixer, a unique cryptographic protocol for authentication. He has also received many rewards for his work and was the technical lead of the EU-funded projects Prime and Prime Life, which both contributed towards making online privacy a reality. Jan, welcome to the show.
Thanks for this introduction, Misha. I'm very happy to be here and to talk to all of you, and looking forward to questions of the communities, and yeah, let's have it.
Fantastic. It's an honor for us to of course have you and showcase Dfinity and talk more about the highly lofty ambitions of your massive project, Internet Computer and ICP. But before we begin, make sure to post any question, guys, you may have to Jan about Dfinity, ICP, the Internet Computer Protocol, during the show, and our back-end team will make sure to pick them out. So let's jump right into it, Jan. Can you tell us more about your personal background and also how you originally got into computer science, cryptography, but especially privacy research and development, and what drives you forward in these fields?
Sure. That's a whole bunch of questions. I mean, yeah, I guess originally I grew up on a little small farm in the mountain of Switzerland. You know, the next neighbor was a couple of hundred meters away. And sort of, well, on one hand, I was always fascinated with mathematics in school. And on the other hand, I guess growing up at farm, you have an edge to practical things, right? We always had a lot of, you know, wood planks lying around. So I always liked constructing. And I guess computer science and cryptography are sort of the both of these parts, right? You have like a lot of mathematics that is sort of fascinating. And then also, I mean, because cryptography is like one of those sciences where we really can do cool stuff. We can build new stuff, right? So it's on one hand, it's really like a science. It's complex mathematics. But on the other hand, it has very, very practical applications, right? We wouldn't have HTTPS without cryptography. And you know, we wouldn't be able to build the internet computer without cryptography. It's like full of complex leading-edge cryptographic protocols that make up the internet computer. And I mean, that's why, yeah, I guess I enjoy the job here so much, because we really can, like, on a daily basis come up with new cryptographic protocols to solve issues that we encounter, you know, solve them, code them up, and get it out into the world, right? That's a great project.
Fantastic. And for those who don't yet know ICP very well, in your own words, what is Dfinity? What is the internet computer? And what's the vision and mission of your project?
Okay, let me start with one of those, and then maybe you can remind me of the other questions. So, yeah, I mean, I guess the internet computer is really the internet computer, like Bitcoin is the digital money. So the internet computer wants to be the computer of the internet, or actually sort of, I mean, the internet today connects computers, right? The internet today allows computers to communicate. So, or it allows us to have this video call. It just pushes bits over pipes. The internet computer extends this with computation, right? So that actually everybody can have access to computation. Everybody can build applications like just on the internet. You don't have to do anything special. So that's the internet computer. That, of course, we do it now because you know, once you have like an open platform having compute services, you also need to worry about, okay, so how is this all financed and so on. So that's where then, of course, ICP or the Internet Computer Protocol come in. You have a decentralized system, and you have tokens that enable actually for this to work, right? When the internet is a decentralized system, but it's the finance of it is very centralized, right? I mean, you pay your ISP, the ISP pays some fees. Whereas on the internet computer, all of that is going to be decentralized.
And regarding the vision and the mission, and we were talking before about you know, lofty ambitions. So we're talking about decades here. How long is your roadmap, and the vision and the mission? How does that fit in?
Yeah. So I mean, to having that vision where really almost all the world software runs on the internet computer, that will take many years. So, and that's also why we are probably the largest R&D organization in the industry. And we're still growing up and building and actually hiring. So if anybody here on the call wants to join this mission, please send me your CVs. So we're growing constantly towards this vision, right? And the vision really is the internet computer be the platform that runs all the software. It should bring, you know, like the ability to you know, invent, to host a new application anywhere in the world. So if you're a developer somewhere, I know, Africa or you know, some really remote place, it's very hard to come up with a new application to run that application to get the funding for it. And so the internet computer also sets out to solve that because of tokenomics, tokenization, decentralization. Essentially, you can deploy your dApp from anywhere. You can tokenize it, and by tokenizing it, also then get all the finances for your dApp. And sort of Dfinity had to have like an office in Palo Alto to tap into the funding of the Bay Area, right? And once we have the internet computer, that will no longer be necessary. He can be like an entrepreneur anywhere in the world and you know, host, launch your applications and do all of that.
Truly democratizing the internet for a new age, huh?
Yeah, I mean, I think the decentralization is really the next stage here. And if you think about the internet, like Web 1 was sort of read. I mean, I guess many of you remember, you know, sort of the first websites. Then you had AltaVista, some search engine that gave you web pages. But it was all static web pages, right? And I remember time when I myself had like a list of cryptographers so that you could look at their web pages. It was all very much consuming. Then you have Web 2, where like Wikipedia came up, where you know, collaboration. And now we're entering Web 3, right? Where users own applications, right? The applications are decentralized. And so the internet computer, in my view, is like the only blockchain actually that allows to do that, right? In other blockchains, of course, you have tokenomics, so you can have people own that, but still a lot of parts of the applications run on Amazon, right? And just call out to a blockchain for the tokens. On the internet computer, it will be all on chain. Your whole application end to end will be on the blockchain. And actually, you can go, there's a ton of examples already of the OpenChat, District, Discover that fully run on the internet computer. And so the internet computer can actually serve web content into your browser, right? You can enter the URL of a dApp into your browser, and then you get it served. So that's really, I guess, in some sense, if you want, the internet computer enables truly Web 3, where users own their contents. It's no longer Facebook, it will be open Facebook. It's no longer WhatsApp, it will be open chat. So I think it's really, we're at the brink of a revolution here in that space.
Oh, I completely agree with you. And it is exciting times for sure. There is currently a very big news out clearly on Twitter that Elon Musk has put in a bid to buy the entire company. How do you see a character and a personality like Elon Musk, who clearly is supportive of decentralized protocols, owns Bitcoin, Ethereum, Doge, while at the same time, you know, is doing a hostile takeover essentially of one of the largest social media platforms? And do you think that that's good or bad for Web3?
Good question. And I haven't even read the tweets yet, because this is news to me. But I guess at the end of the day, because that's normal business, right? But I think I mean, social media should be open, right? And if there's like a single party controlling it, it's no longer open. And if you have a platform like the internet computer, like the code is open source, and you have a decentralized governance, hopefully the governance of the internet computer is so much decentralized that somebody like Elon Musk cannot take it over, right? Because if he wanted to take it over, he would have to buy tokens. If he started to buy tokens, the price would go up. So, maybe Elon Musk might be the only guy who could afford that, but I doubt it, right? I mean, not even he can sort of buy as many tokens to keep the price going. So it's sort of not possible to take the internet computer over. And I think in a similar fashion, it would not be possible to take something like OpenChat open, right? If the community owns it, and nobody can take it over, right? So I think that's the whole point of Web3. The users own the applications and all their data, right? So, So I think it's good. I mean, Elon doing that is good for us to say, well, actually, look, Web3, you shouldn't be able to do that. Social media has to be Web3. It has to be owned by the user.
Indeed. Yeah, perhaps it's a necessary bridge to get to that point, but I guess only time will tell. I think the current bid was $41 billion to buy 100% stake in Twitter. But we'll see what happens. He just put it out like 2-3 hours ago. So.
Okay. Well, hopefully somebody listening here wants to do open Twitter on the internet computer and sort that out in that way.
Yeah, we'll get to the different dApps that are being built on ICP. It's a very interesting ecosystem that's being formed. But before we go to that, privacy in our digital age is a very subjective concept. But I personally believe we all have a human right to privacy. What made you pursue your academic and professional career in the field of privacy technology? And what does privacy truly mean to you?
Yeah, I guess privacy is in some sense like a difficult term. It can mean many different things to many people, right? I mean, if you, it's always like, I guess, in context of society, you know, like to as you say, like I've worked more than 25 years in the space of privacy, like had many discussions. What does privacy mean? How it has evolved over time? Like in the medieval times, the bathroom was actually, just in the corner next to the table. So people didn't have any issues with that. Today, that would be unthinkable. In some countries, they have curtains. In other countries, actually, they don't have curtains. It's just totally fine to walk by and look into somebody's house. So I think privacy means different things to different people, right? But I think to me, at the end of the day, privacy means being in control of your own person, right? I mean, about data about you, but you can sort of this self-determination, right? The right to self-determination. Yeah, and so that means, and I think it's in the physical world, it's much easier to do that, right? I mean, you can decide whether you want to have curtains or not. Can decide where your bathroom will be located, all of that. It's much easier, right? In the physical, in the digital world, it's way harder because, in some sense, when you are at your computer or at your phone, it always feels private because, it's in your living room, it's in your office where you feel at home. It always feels private, right? And you don't, it's very hard to grasp, okay, but who else has software on your mobile phone, on your computer? Who else collects data? Where does this data go? Yeah, and then we're sort of in this, okay, so how can we protect that, right? How can we control that? How can we build secure operating systems? So it's this, how can we build applications? How can we build platforms that allow people to control their privacy? And again, but back to Twitter and Facebook and Google and all this tech monopolies who very much are interested in data and make it very hard for us today to control our data. And also here, like I think for the internet building the internet computer, it's also building dApps that do have privacy, right? They're actually, you know, like it's very much defined what the protocol does, how data can be processed. It's part of the protocol, right? And sort of, and obviously, right now, in the traditional blockchains have zero privacy because you just download the whole state. In the internet computer, like application subnets, actually the state is not public, so the dApp can decide by themselves what kind of interfaces they make available to their data. And but short of that, I mean, the internet computer protects the data there, right? So it's only the data is protected by the dApp, and the source code, well, again, the dApp can decide or not, but in principle that dApp could make the source code open, right? And so then everybody could verify how the data is treated. And the vision here is also that the internet computer at some point you upload the source code, it compiles it, and then you get a certificate. This is all compiled like that. You can verify the source code, and you have full transparency, and your data is fully protected. So that's what we want to work towards, right?
Thank you for that answer, and also understanding a little bit more about the privacy protections that are coming on ICP. As I just mentioned in the beginning of the show, we just came back from Miami, me and part of the team. And personally, I'm a massive Bitcoin bull in terms of long-term, don't say, eating of the monetary world, perhaps. But ICP is working on a direct integration with the Bitcoin network using your own technology called chain key cryptography. And we're not talking about a wrapped BTC like you have on Ethereum and Avalanche and Solana and so on, but something entirely different. Can you give us an explanation of your integration of Bitcoin, perhaps an update on the progress development, and of course, the larger implications of this Bitcoin integration on ICP?
Yeah, of course, it is my pleasure. So, yeah, I think it's important to notice this is not wrapped Bitcoin, right? So, I mean, for those that don't know, wrapped Bitcoin sort of means that you send your Bitcoin to a Bitcoin public key, and that public key then is sort of controlled and owned by some party that run the blockchain that wraps it. In this case here, what we do is chain key cryptography. We use threshold cryptography to give a canister, a smart contract on the internet computer, like a public key and then the private key. But the private key is secret shared across all the nodes a subset of the nodes of the internet computer. So that means as long as the internet computer is secure, also your private key is secure. So it uses the same threshold cryptography. So there's mathematical proofs here that as long as a fraction of the node are honest, your secret key is safe, right? So and now with that, of course, now every smart contract on the internet computer can have an ECDSA public key. So ECDSA is the elliptic curve digital signature algorithm. So you can have these public keys. And so that means that every smart contract can have their own public key where people can send Bitcoin to, right? And so now a smart contract or a canister, as we call them on the internet computer, can interact interact with Bitcoin, right? Because you can now use that public key and send Bitcoin to that public key. Now, Bitcoin integration just makes sure that actually now this interaction will work, right? So that a canister, a smart contract on the internet computer can actually send, interact with the Bitcoin miners to read the UTXO set. So every canister, so the nodes of the internet computer will pull the blocks from the Bitcoin miners. You know, like find consensus on that where they're actually finalized and whatnot. Pull together the UTXO set and make it available to canisters, right? And so then canisters actually can see okay which public keys have how many Bitcoin and all of that, can receive Bitcoin, right? If their public key is in the set, can send Bitcoin, and of course the sending again means signing a transaction with their ECDSA public key, and then sending this transaction off to the Bitcoin miners into the memory pool. And that transaction, of course, I mean, once it's signed, I mean, there's like all the nodes of the internet computer can just then submit this transaction to the memory pool, and then it gets included in Bitcoin. And after, you know, like so many hours, decades, whatnot, right? I mean, because Bitcoin is inherently slow. But then also have these transactions validated and make you know, read UTXO sets again and see whether the transaction actually has been finalized.
It's fascinating. You have companies like Stax and RSK that have attempted and still attempting to build smart contracts and dApps, decentralized applications on top of Bitcoin using the Bitcoin network. But clearly, as you were speaking of, it is inherently slow and it's inherently simple in its infrastructure and design. Can dApp builders build smart contracts that are interacting directly with Bitcoin on top of Bitcoin using ICP?
Yeah, I mean, so what we're also going to do, we'll build like a special dApp, like a ledger dApp on the IC that will have Bitcoin itself, right? And then again, because this is secure, it will be controlled by the internet computer network nervous system. So we have like a secure, if you want bank, right? And so again, a ledger or in some sense, again, you could call it like wrapped. I mean, it's not wrapped Bitcoin again, but it's really more like a bank where you can have Bitcoin accounts. And so by that, actually, we allow developers to do smart contracts with Bitcoin that can have two-second finality, right? Because that they can interact, can actually send Bitcoin on that ledger directly on the internet computer. And of course, then you can make calls out to the Bitcoin network if you want, or make calls in from the Bitcoin network. And with that, you can actually do smart contracts using Bitcoin with two-second finality.
Fascinating. We support your efforts. Anything that's being built with Bitcoin and expanding the Bitcoin world is welcomed, in my opinion. Let's talk user experience and developer experience as well. At Klever, one of our core values when delivering products for both regular users as well as developers is simple user experience. Everyone should be able to use and build on top of a blockchain of their choice. How does simplicity and ease of deployment permeate Dfinity's work on the internet computer?
Yeah, actually, I'm just coming out of a meeting where we discussed the new website, smartcontracts.org, that should be available, I think, end of next week, where we do a serious revamp of the developer website that you'll see will be way, way simpler, way more accessible than had been in the past. And so I think it's also the history we went through, right? So we were sort of building in stealth mode until like May of last year to launch our network. We were very much focused internally. Then we've launched, and then now we're sort of developer experience and interfacing with developers becomes increasingly important, and we're building out that team as well. And so we're seeing the first fruit of that happening. We're having calls with the developer now. We have what we call the global R&D, which was a purely internal meeting, now that we invite developers in that as well. And hopefully in a few months, even that internal meeting will be fully open, so any developer can join. Right now, we sort of say, okay, if a developer has a nice demo, they can join, right? So sort of like an entry ticket. We'll do that for a while, but then eventually this should become fully open, so that the threshold for developers to build on the internet computer should be as low as possible. But having said that, right, I mean, we have a very active forum.dfinity.org, where all the researchers and then engineers interact with developers, answer questions. We're ramping up there, right? We have a strong R&D org that is not like slowly gets used to interact with developers. And we can also see here almost an exponential, well, clearly an exponential growth if you look at the amount of canisters or smart contracts on the internet computer. It starts to grow exponentially, and we'll see that growth continue. I'm very convinced, and as the growth continues, we're also scaling up our developer facing teams so that we can make it even easier for developers to start building.
Amazing. In Klever, we support many different features for ICP, but one of them is clearly staking, right? And you have a bit different terminology and methodology around staking. How does staking on ICP work? Can you give us a brief layout of the staking process involving neurons on the internet computer? And what are the incentives involved with ICP staking?
Yeah, so staking is about, I mean, it's also about contributing to the internet computer, right? It's the governance or the network nervous system of the internet computer. And so that means if you want to take part in the governance of the internet computer, which is really, I mean, the decentralized, if you want board of the internet computer, right? Every user can determine via votes how the internet computer should evolve. And that involves, and we're the only blockchain actually where this is all fully automatic. So if we want to, or if the internet computer wants to upgrade, so right now the Dfinity Foundation makes a proposal to the network nervous system, says, okay, here's the latest version of the code. Do you want to run the latest version? And then every neuron holder, so the neuron holders are those people who stake the ICP, that then can look at this proposal, can say yes or no. And if the majority of them say yes, then that code gets automatically deployed on all the nodes of the internet computer. So it's like a full automatic governance system. And proposals involve stuff like updating nodes. It involves changing parameters of the network nervous system. It also involves like motion proposals, which are not technically actable. It's more like, okay, so now high level topics, right? Let's do this. Could we also do this? Can also vote on that. And so in order to become a neuron holder, you buy ICP on an exchange. You go to the NNS front end app, which is nns.ic0.app. You go there, you create an account. And then you can create a neuron, can put ICP into the neuron, and then you're ready to go and vote. Or you take the Klever app, download that one, and can stake there. And of course, one feature that you guys still have to do, the voting part, right? But once you guys have added hotkeys, then actually you could add the principal of the front end app that you have as a hotkey in Klever, then you can also actually vote from there. So you guys are sort of working on that. I'm not quite sure. We had been discussing that would be the next step so that people can vote.
But the idea, I checked in with our blockchain before you continue. I checked in with our blockchain team before Klever Labs. They are working on this voting feature, and it's coming.
So great news. So here we go. We have an announcement, right? Yeah. So, and the thing here is, right, I mean, if you want to, I mean, staking here really means participation in the network, right? It's not, you don't run a node and so on, because our nodes run at cost. So if you want to be a node, become a node provider also, right, you buy the necessary hardware, you send a proposal to the NNS. The NNS says, do we need a node in Stockholm, do we need a node in Vienna, wherever, right? And then we say, we need a node there. And then the NNS can vote on that or accept it or reject it. And then the node provider then gets paid for their services. But again, at cost. So the computational cost, you know, if you have a dApp on the internet computer, you know how much it's going to be costing in 10 years out, right? It's not when with Ethereum or gas where, if the ETH price goes up, you can no longer afford to run your smart contract on Ethereum. On the internet computer, the prices won't change, or if they change, they will go down, right? Because the no providers are rewarded in ICP, but the conversion rate that mirrors their real costs, right? So we have the different costs in different geolocations, and it's like the actual costs. And likewise, the smart contracts are just built the actual costs. They're built in cycles, which is more or less, you know, packed to XDR, which is like a bag of different currencies, so that developers know how much their smart contracts will cost also down in 10 years. Of course, it will become cheaper the more we, you know, like improve our performance, the more, you know, the more operations we can do on a node, and the node cost will hopefully be also stable, or hardware will become cheaper, more powerful. So the cost should only go down, not up.
You know, your team, I think it consists now of more than 215 collaborators and researchers around the world. I want to understand a little bit more, how does your operations work? We're a remote global company with no headquarters at Klever, and we work through this pandemic in the same way that we did before. We just learned a lot through it. How do you at Dfinity work? How do you collaborate? How do you get all of these great minds coming together?
Yeah, I think it's a mixture between remote and local. So, I mean, we have research centers in Palo Alto, San Francisco, Zurich. So these are the biggest centers. But then we have also a lot of people that are working remote. And of course, during the pandemic, it became a more remote organization. But I mean, we just opened, I guess we announced that we're opening a new office in Zurich. And we will move into that office in June. And the office should fit about 120 people. And the thing is, you know, so some of the, you know, like it's the internet computer or cryptography or these protocols that we do, they are rather complex. And I think at the end of the day, nothing beats a few smart people in front of a whiteboard to solve a problem. We sort of seen that in the pandemic. I think maybe the first 3-4 months we were like speeding up quite a bit, because I guess nobody could do anything else other than working. And sort of everything was on lockdown, and of course we sort of had all this solved problems already, just to work, you know, to implement, to code up, and so. But then after that, we could also see a slowdown, because when before, maybe we would have solved a hard problem in the course of a week, right? Now it sort of took way longer. It took a couple of months, because virtual whiteboards maybe are not just where they are right now. And so I guess we sort of do both, I guess maybe the best of both worlds, right? So I guess people come in, we work in the office together. Even if we do Zoom calls, right, we have cameras on the whiteboard, so it also works remotely, a few people on the whiteboard. But I guess, yeah, we'll see where the world takes us post the pandemic. I think it's probably going to be a mixture of working remote, coming to the office for some meetings and solving problems, then maybe going back home to code things up, because it's more quiet there. Yeah, let's see where it goes, right? I mean,
so with such large operations and so many research centers, a lot of discussions around smart contract protocols and other blockchain protocols are, of course, funding. Like, where do you get your funding, and how do you make it decentralized over time? How do you fund your operations, and how will that look over the next decade and so?
Well, I guess initially we had a lot of like venture capital before we launched, and now since we launched, our funding of course comes from token. How this plays out in the next decades, I guess eventually, I mean, it will be from tokens one way or the other. Of course, also the foundation is also staking some of the ICP, so we get voting rewards from that. So that's a source of income. But who knows what the future brings, right? How a new business model come up in a decentralized world, I'm sure we're going to see a lot of new ways to funding through tokenization and whatnot. But yeah. Anyway, we're well funded right now, so I guess and we are also can grow quite a bit for the next couple of years. And you know, the plans go for maybe 3 years, and thereafter we will see what comes.
Excellent. Yeah, you seem like a very not only goal-oriented organization, but also flexible to the environments around the space. Internet Computer uses Motoko, Dfinity's own programming language for application development, and WebAssembly as its virtual machine. Can you elaborate on the advantages and disadvantages of using Motoko as programming languages and WebAssembly as your VM?
Yeah, sure. So I mean, Motoko is not the only language. We also support Rust natively, right? And actually, so some of the community members have started like other SDKs. So essentially, like whatever you can do that can be compiled into WASM will work as programming languages, right? Of course, you need to make sure that is deterministic, because you run it on a replicated system, and of course, if you compile something into WebAssembly, that will not be deterministic. You will run into problems. But that's more like a technical issue. So at the end of the day, you want to be able, you know, to program the internet computer in any language you want, and you just compile it into WASM. Now, why do we use Motoko, right? I mean, so Motoko was especially designed to make it easier to program, implement like a decentralized asynchronous system. Because I mean, if you compare like with Ethereum Solidity, it's essentially synchronous, right? I mean, you have all the smart contracts that are all together, can call each other. It's all synchronous call. That doesn't scale, right? If you want to scale out, like the internet itself, it's an asynchronous system. You make calls to others, you get the answer back, and then of course, if you get the answer back, you might have made other calls, and so your system changes. And it becomes quickly very complex if you build like a large system. And the Motoko was designed to make that easier, right? It's designed as a programming language for an asynchronous system. So that's why, you know, we also want to make it easier for developers to use the platform. But obviously, I mean, if you're at home with Rust, then maybe you're better off using Rust, and you should totally be able to use Rust or like another language, but
any other.
Yeah. I mean, right now there's no SDK for Golang, so you know, anybody listening in and they want to do Golang, sure, give it a try. And we also do have grants and to fund projects, so you could just you know, fund a Golang. I think also here, I mean, the foundation is about to build the Internet Computer Protocol, right? And so that's and because it is a very complex system, so something complex like that, it's very hard to build by a community. But hopefully one day that will change as well, right? But like an SDK for Golang, that's something the community can easily take up, and hopefully it will, right? We want to build, you know, the Internet Computer should not be the foundation, right? It cannot be, right? It's a decentralized project, and so by definition, it's now not the foundation anymore. We're one of the contributors to the space, but we encourage everybody else to contribute as well. And you know, it has to. If the internet computer becomes the internet computer, it has to be owned by everybody, and everybody can contribute, and hopefully does contribute.
So speaking of dApps, you're still early, clearly. We're talking about quite a new project in the space, perhaps long planning ahead of time. But what dApps are being built currently that you're excited about? What are you seeing out there in terms of usability and applications? What's being built on ICP?
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's a decentralized system, so I do not know what the apps are being built per se, right? I know we have, I guess I don't have access to the dashboard right now, but somewhere close to 60,000 smart contracts or canister that are being run right now on the internet computer. What we know, so and of course these could be like 60,000 different dApps, but actually they're not. I know some dApps like OpenChat where every user has their own canister. So depending on the architecture of the dApps, of course, a dApp is many canisters together. We did some recently try to figure out how many like repositories we could like identify out there in the world. We ended up something like 1,000-1,500 code repositories that were somehow related to the internet computer. I bet there's a ton of them that are not public. So I don't know. Maybe right now there's 1,000-2,000 dApps. But as I was saying, we see like an increasing amount. What dApps I'm excited about, I think that, you know, like anything social that tokenizes, like OpenChat is clearly exciting, where you can see that you can have, you know, a chat applications live on a blockchain. I mean, it's sort of mind-blowing. Going further, we have some developers that do video streaming of the internet computer, you know, like a version of Netflix on the internet computer. It's the early stages. We have people that do like multiplayer games. We have people that do metaverse. We have a gallery, like a 3D. It's really like a gallery, right? A 3D gallery where you can, from your browser, walk to a building, see pictures. I mean, and just a glimpse, right? It tells you the potential of what actually the internet computer can serve directly from the blockchain into people's browsers.
Fascinating. A lot of protocols, both blockchain and others, have been trying to solve the data storage and the data storage cost in a decentralized way. We have BitTorrent, Filecoin, and many others. Low on-chain data storage costs is something that you pride highly in ICP. How do you solve decentralized storage when we're speaking of a global internet computer?
Well, I think the goal here is like a thin waste at the end of the day, right? So that every canister has its own memory, and I guess there we have the $5 per gigabyte per year. But so and then you have like this little, you know, canister, little pieces, and then you build up larger data stores with that. I mean, in a traditional way, right? Or traditional way, because it's sort of then what we call big map, where we distribute the data across a couple of canisters, build an index canister that manages that. But also here we're early days, right? We were also just discussing this week our roadmap for making available larger memory, and the architecture I just mentioned, right? Where a canister has I guess now 8 gigabytes of local memory, and then if you want to scale out, you have to have more canisters. But that's only one way to scale up. We're also discussing other ways to give more memory to canisters. Again, it's sort of early days, and we'll see many optimizations possible, many different architectures play out. And yeah, I guess that's as much as can say now about the storage. It's a lot of that is work in progress, and it's on our roadmap to do that.
So you touched now twice on the roadmap. Can you go in a little bit? And you can go as far as a decade or two or a year, it's up to you. But what's coming next in terms of features, in terms of infrastructure, in terms of architecture? What can the community look forward to in terms of your roadmap?
Well, the next big thing, obviously, is Bitcoin integration, which we already talked about. So that will be done by end of May. It's our current planning. I mean, it's like software, right? You never know if you hit something on unforeseen, it might end up quite differently from what you had planned. But I mean, it looks pretty good. So I guess with all likelihood, we're going to make that. So that will be big. The next thing that we're working on, and also we're working with early developers to get that done, is SNS, service network system. So this will be like a network system for dApps. So the dApp can actually tokenize themselves. It's a governance system. So dApps can have their own neurons, can have their own proposals, right? And then their own tokens. And so now sort of dApp can really tie in into the internet computer. And the vision is that in some sense, you know, if you want to do an ICO, which has a lot of potential trap falls, you can just do that automatically on the internet computer with a press of a button, right? You say, okay, so now I have a dApp, I want to decentralize, tokenize that dApp, and then the internet computer just does that for you, right? I mean, the idea is that it runs an auction for you, you get as a developer, you get some tokens, but it auctions off the rest of the tokens, and then boom, you have funding for your dApp, you are decentralized, and you can then vote on the upgrades of your dApp. Just the, you know, decentralization with a touch of the button. So that's the big vision. We'll have the first version of governance out in a few weeks, and then gradually we build it out. We'll have like front ends to it until yeah, I can't really say much about the concrete timeline, but I mean, we're working with high pressure on having this sort of tokenization for the apps on the internet computer as well.
I was doing some research before also about the space that you are building in regarding any competitors, if anyone is trying even to attempt the lofty ambitions that you guys at Dfinity have. What competitors do you at Dfinity have in the market today, and how do you see the competitive landscape in your field looking like in the coming years?
Yeah, I don't know. I guess for the coming years, you would need like a glass ball, right? I think in some sense, we have no competitors, and we have many competitors, right? I mean, I think we have no competitors in the sense that I think we have the strongest and greatest research team in the whole industry, and that's something you can't just copy, right? I mean, of course, our code is open source. You could just take the code and try to run from there. But I mean, if you don't have the R&D organization to support that, you can't do that, right? So it's from that point of view, I think we are pretty unique. On the other hand, of course, if you look at coin market cap, where the internet computer is with respect to others, so we have a ton of competition, right? And we all compete for developers, we all compete for capital, and yeah, so that's the landscape out there. And I mean, our goal totally is to be in the top space of that landscape of course as soon as possible, but I mean it will take a while. I mean this we're in this for the long game, right? Our planning space, or you know, our vision is like a 20-year roadmap vision, and we just relentlessly go towards that vision, and one step after another, one at a time. That's what we do.
Love it. We do have a community question before my last question. I'll actually pop that in. This is about other services that are currently out there. So how will this, essentially the Internet Computer Project, affect big and small businesses that live and rely on Web2 internet space, like Amazon Web Services, hosting companies, and others? And how can you migrate those big and small businesses to ICP?
Yeah, I guess it will make their lives way easier once they have migrated. And of course, like migration is never easy, right? I mean, if you have a ton of legacy software, migrate from a ton of legacy software to a new space, it's very hard, right? And so I think what we first see will be like new applications, new organizations, new businesses that will form on the internet computer, and then the like existing businesses will slowly migrate as more tools become available, as more commodity software, commodity canisters become available that allow them to migrate. But I think for that point of view, it's probably very similar to like normal software, right? If you want to migrate from one solution to another solution, it's just painful. It takes time. But at least for the internet computer, you're running on open software, right? I mean, if you choose to rely on the new software, you can have the option to choose on open software. So, it's owned by the community. You should no longer be, at the mercy of some big monopolistic companies that can just from one day or another decide to no longer support some APIs and no longer support some software. Right, so it will be owned by the community, and the community can decide how they would want to, evolve with their software, whether an API should be changed or not. Right, so I think it will be a way better world, but it probably takes quite a while until legacy enterprises have been made that step.
Thank you. Very insightful answer, actually. You're the CTO of Dfinity. You're building this massive project that has a roadmap of two decades ahead. What are you most excited about today in 2022, as well as over the coming decade, about your project?
Like I said, what in some sense gets me most excited is just the team that we have, and every day coming to work and then be able to work with such a great team. I think that's the first thing that excites me, right? And the next thing is really like working with such a great team towards that vision of the internet computer, right? Eventually having this all in place. And it's really like all these steps, but I mean, what excites me is more the long term thing, rather. I mean, the next step, of course, as well, right? We will have Bitcoin integration. That will be exciting. We'll have threshold cryptography that we build in-house, proof secure, all of that being in the wild. I mean, each of those things are very exciting, right? So, but I mean, at the end of the day, it's really having such a great team, working with great people towards the great vision. I mean, that's the big excitement. All the other things are bony on the way towards there.
Fantastic. Well, Jan, thank you very much for sharing all your knowledge, your experience, and all the development going on in Dfinity and Internet Computer. We at Klever and all of our viewers truly appreciate it.
Thanks a lot, Misha. It was all my pleasure. Thank you.
And thank you guys out there for tuning in wherever you were in the world and whichever platform you watched in. And remember, until next time, your only limit is you.